Good afternoon and welcome to another edition of Dropping Jewels in Kansas City with Morgan. I'm your co-host, John Donnelly. Coming off the holidays, as you noticed, we've been off for the holidays. I hope everyone had a wonderful Christmas, a wonderful New Year's. Coming off a tough loss by the Chiefs this weekend, the Cincinnati puts us at the 2 seed. And winter weather has finally arrived in Kansas City. But to put an end to all that and have some good vibes, we are joined in studio by KC Kempter, who is a local artist and is knowledgeable about the Kansas City art scene. And we're glad to have you in studio this afternoon, KC. Glad we were able to get you. I know we've done a little bit of back and forth over the last week, the holidays withstanding.
Absolutely.
So why don't you tell everyone about yourself and talk a little bit about the art scene here in Kansas City?
Sure. My name is KC Kempter. I am a local artist. Lived in Kansas City all my life. Just a little bit about my background is, I really wanted to not be a starving artist. So I've been a professional in the telecommunications industry, the logistics industry for the past 15 or so years. And over the last, I would say 5 years, I decided to really give it a real good shot at trying to make it as a professional artist. So that's kind of a little bit about probably what I'll talk about today is just that journey, that struggle that I'm sure a lot of people, maybe go through in the art scene here in Kansas. And then talk a little bit about, what's happened lately with COVID and how that's impacted my goals and kind of maybe, talk a little bit about what it looks like now after kind of the, I don't know if we're in the endemic, but we're getting close. I feel like things are starting to turn a corner and maybe get a little bit back to normal. So those are the kind of the topics that I thought I would chat about today.
And those are wonderful topics. And so to get to that, let's talk a little bit about yourself. Because, Morgan and I celebrate any type of entrepreneurship.
Sure.
And you coming from a professional industry and then going into doing the arts yourself.
Yeah.
What type of art do you like to create? What is your genre or medium that people would
I'm kind of a jack of all trades as an artist. I pretty much like to turn art into, make art out of anything I can get my hands on. So I do a lot of sculptural work. I do a lot of traditional oil painting, a lot of pen, ink, pencil drawing, just basically whatever I can get my hands on, I like to make art out of. So, you'll see me sometimes at like flea markets or, antique shops. And I look for anything that I can incorporate into my paintings or, or make a sculpture out of. So I just like to get my hands in all of it. So, I don't really have one specific thing that I like to do. I just like to do a little bit of everything.
Absolutely.
So do you get commissioned by people?
I do. Yeah. I've done quite a few commissions, which kind of leads me into some of my topics. Prior to COVID, we have a pretty good art scene here in Kansas. You have the Westport Art Fair, you have the Plaza Art Fair, you have the Brookside Art Fair. Like there's an art fair in Lee Summit. There's an Art in the Park in Lawrence. Mm-hmm. I still feel like a thriving art scene here in Kansas. And one of the great things that I love about Kansas is that it's got that big city feel, but not that big city crunch. You don't feel like everybody's on top of everybody,
right.
But we still have a, pretty vibrant city, and I love all the galleries that we have. There's a plethora of galleries throughout downtown and in the Crossroads District,
right.
That are still,
Crossroads.
Yeah. First Fridays, is a good venue. It's the first Friday of every month. Mm-hmm. And so I would say that, when COVID hit, a lot of those shows kind of, canceled. And there was a good probably 2 years, 2019, 2020, where those shows were all canceled. And, you know, really you had to seek art out, I feel like, during that time. So it's kind of a struggle, you know, as a self-employed artist, you know, to navigate those waters, I feel like. Mm-hmm. So I saw a lot of my peers and a lot of my friends who also do art kind of switch more to like enforcing and improving their online web presence, you right. know, so like whether it's building out your website, you know, or getting out there on Instagram or Facebook or social media, I feel like a lot of artists kind of focused more towards that as opposed to going to your traditional gallery and trying to get exhibitions that way.
Absolutely. You know, me being a digital marketer, I'm always a fan of any digital mediums that will represent an individual, because I think that's where we're at right now.
Sure.
And I'm not, you know, I'm certain you understand that that will probably continue, mm-hmm. but you do like the connectivity of the art shows and the Absolutely. Galleries and things of that nature. What galleries have you been affiliated with in Kansas City in your time as an artist?
Sure. I was in the first art gallery of Olathe for quite some time. They were located off of 119th and like I-35. Mm-hmm. And then I've been in the 2010 art gallery. And so they were previously down in the Crossroads. They've since moved to Overland Park, I believe. But those were two of the galleries that I've been exhibiting in the past.
Absolutely. Very, very nice galleries.
Yeah, too. Definitely.
Great places to represent your work.
Sure.
So let's talk a little bit about the Kansas City art scene. Let's Absolutely. Go big to small. I love the Nelson Art Gallery.
Yeah.
And obviously, you can see some of the world famous artists, and I understand at one time, and it still may be, it was one of the top five museums in the world,
Absolutely.
You know, for the exhibits they get and the art that they have in the gallery.
Yeah.
And then you talk about the art scene here for local artists such as yourself. How important is it to have a museum of the class of the Nelson, you know, and then locally, you bring that yeah. ground locally to maybe like the Kempter, which uh-huh. is another sort of big museum.
Sure.
But then you've got, like you mentioned, the Crossroads sections, the Olathe Art Gallery, mm-hmm. and all these fantastic places you can go to see local artists, artisans. Does that help any with the reputation of the artists here in Kansas City? Have you found that that's helped you any?
Absolutely. You know, it's having those types of museums local to you is always a boon as an artist, because you can go to those places and just wander around for hours and get tons of inspiration. Mm-hmm. You know, it's definitely a place I like to visit and just soak in all the beautiful masterpieces that they have on display. They regularly switch out their art, you know, mm-hmm. and for new exhibitions that come through town. So it's definitely amazing to have access to places like that as an artist, just for inspiration. And I mean, if you're not artistically inclined, it's also a great time out with your kids and family, and, you know, go look at some paintings and have a good time with your kids and let them see some stuff that they probably wouldn't see, you know?
Absolutely. You just described me, because my kids, every time they come to town, they live out of state,
uh-huh.
and they love the Nelson. I love the Nelson.
Absolutely.
I am not artistically inclined in any way. I've been fortunate to be surrounded by people such as yourself
sure.
and Morgan, who is an artist in his own right, creating wonderful pieces of jewelry. So what do you find has been your inspiration for being an artist in the type of art that you create?
I like modern art, contemporary art. Mm-hmm. There's, you know, everybody has their own flavor when they look at art, what speaks to them. And that's the great thing about art, is it's subjective. And, you know, one person might see something that they love in a painting, and another person might absolutely be like, well, that's not for me. Mm-hmm. But you can always find something. So I think what has been inspiring to me the most is just, I like to go and, you know, and check out any kind of modern art, any kind of up and coming artists, or First Fridays is a great example. If you don't know what you're looking for, but you would like to get involved in the art world or art scene, you know, that's a great place to start, because you can check out multiple galleries in one evening and see all kinds of different styles of art, and, you know, and find something that speaks to you and what, and find out what your tastes are as a consumer of art.
Okay. Other than Kansas City, what would you say, what are areas of the country that might be comparable to our art scene in that manner?
Well, I would say, you know, I just recently visited New Orleans, and they have an incredible art scene down there. There's Magazine Street, Royal Street. There's they have probably 2 to 3 galleries on every street corner down there. So going there was incredible. And seeing all the art and what inspires the local artists there. And I think that's the great thing about seeking out art in other states or cities is that you kind of get a flavor of the people through art. Mm-hmm. You can see kind of what inspires the local people and the local people who create art. You can see a lot of the vibe of the city that way, mm-hmm. and get a feeling of the culture that way. So it's a great way to get to know, you know, a city that you're visiting is by going out and checking out some art in that city. But I would say New Orleans has a great art scene. New York, even though I've never been, I would love to go. Miami had Art Basel, which is a huge art show.
My sister was just down there for that.
Absolutely. Yeah, I would love to go to that. We're thinking about we were thinking about going down there and checking it out this year, but kind of got sidetracked a little bit. Hopefully we might be able to make it down there next year.
Yeah, that's a wonderful.
What do you think about the Art Institute?
Oh, the Art Institute is a great institution. I hate to divide the audience, or be controversial, but, you know, there's usually two ways of thinking when it comes to like art education.
Right.
Some people, you know, really think that they want to attend art school, and there's nothing wrong with that. And some people learn on their own. There's a lot. I know a lot of self-taught artists, mm-hmm. a lot of well-off self-taught artists, but I also know a lot of well-off, artists that have a formal education in art. I would say there's value in it, because as an artist, you still have to know the fundamentals. Just like I'm sure with jewelry, you still have to know the fundamentals, the basic building blocks of what makes good art. You know, you have to have a good understanding of, you know, what trends are, you know, active right now, what trends are hot right now, you know, what people really look for in a painting, or, mm-hmm. you know, a certain style of painting. So there's nothing wrong with the formal education. You know, I highly recommend anybody who's interested in, you know, exploring an art education to go that route.
Yeah, I live the 42nd Locust, which is real close to where the Art Institute. Mm-hmm. My roommate, who's the real, he was very forward-thinking, brilliant man. And we were talking about art one evening, and he says, well, let's go see what we can find. Mm-hmm. So we went over to the Art Institute, and it was the end of the semester, and we did some dumpster diving.
Oh, wow.
And we got in there, and we got out these workbooks these kids had been working on. And to this day, I'm in awe they did. Like, mm-hmm. this one scene. They did their project was to do a bar scene, uh-huh. with like about 90 different people in it.
Yeah.
And they were all individual characters.
Oh, wow.
Completely fleshed out with shading and everything, you know. And I looked at that and I said, oh my God.
Yeah.
That would have taken forever.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
And so to me, I just saw that and I said, you know, it's like Walt Disney, you know, he would go around and check on his artists after work and he would pull the trash out, mm. right, and unwind and look at it. And he wrote a note on a couple of it. Said, "You're throwing away your best work."
Yeah, right.
And they did the same thing down at the Art Institute. They were throwing away some of their best work.
Absolutely. Well, sometimes as an artist, there is a saying amongst artists that, you know, a painting is never finished. It's just, you just stop working on it. Right. So sometimes, you know, and every artist has 20 horrible paintings sitting at their house right now that they're, you know, that they've, I wouldn't say given up on, but that can happen. You know, sometimes you just move on, you know.
Well, they say the enemy of good is better.
Exactly.
And let's stay with that for a second. As a burgeoning artist or one that's trying to make a name for himself, when I think about what you and Morgan just mentioned, when you look at works of art, and like you just said, sometimes for me, it may be, this is brilliant. And then for you, it's like, well, I don't really care for that.
Sure.
When you create art, it obviously has to be in your image, to your liking.
Oh, yeah.
And do you ever concern yourself about, will people receive this? Or is that even a way to approach anything?
Absolutely. You know, as an artist, I struggle with that all the time, between making something that I love and that I would like to create, versus, you know, will somebody appreciate this? Will somebody want to buy this, basically, is the end result, you know, because I mean, we as artists have to pay our bills too, you know, right. And it is a struggle because, you know, when you're an entrepreneur, you know, you're, need to pay for your own healthcare. Yeah. You need to pay for your own dental visits. You need to, you know, everything comes out of pocket. So the ultimate goal is to make something that somebody is going to want and to ultimately give you money for, basically. Absolutely. You know, compensate you for your time. So there is a real struggle there sometimes on, you know, is this more something for myself that I want to see executed, or is it something that I think that the consumer is going to want or appreciate? So there is a little bit of that struggle, but I mean, I think the key to it is to find a middle ground, a happy middle ground. Mm-hmm. You know, put enough of yourself into a piece of art that you can recognize yourself in it and your love of creating it for, and also enough broad of a, you know, of a, an experience for someone to look at that and want to, you know, get that for themselves.
Right. And I appreciate that thought because I come from a world in digital marketing where it's very academic and structured.
Sure. Right?
And so you follow the rules that Google has set forth and things are supposed to work out. And typically they do. The dichotomy of that in that world is the graphic designer who has the opportunity to be creative. However, they are still following a set of rules to make it fit in the digital realm.
Sure.
So my thought to that is, and I'm going to ask you this, as you're trying to build yourself as an artist, have you ever thought about any realm in that where, hey, I could create some logos, I could, you know, to pay some bills.
Sure.
And, you know, I could, you know, study graphic design, which is a beast in and of itself, because you may have this painting and then you have to follow these scales and of that nature. When you create art, do you think about scale or do you think about the economy of scale for every piece that you have? Because I would imagine there has to be materials and things of that nature.
I love that question. That is, you have to think about all of those things. When you are an entrepreneur, you know, whether it's jewelry, whether it's, you know, video production, podcasts, you know, marketing even, you have to think about all of those things when you're putting some content out for the, you know, the public, or when you're creating a piece of jewelry, you know, you have to think, what is my time involved in this? You know, how much did it cost me to make this? You know, because everybody's time is worth something, you know, so you definitely think about that. And I'm sure as you guys have experienced, you have to wear multiple hats when you're an entrepreneur, you know, whether it be a, you're a plumber or, you know, you own your own business, you have to be your own marketing department. You have to be your own website expert. You have to be your own photographer, you know. So there is all of that and, you know, time that goes into all of that. So I think it comes down to like time management, you know. Finding the time to do what you love as well as what whatever it is that you're making or producing. But also there's a business aspect to it that not everybody is probably great at, or maybe you are great at it, but I mean, there's struggles there as well. So I think it's just finding the time to do both and getting good at certain things, you know, over time.
Right. And that brings me back to where you were saying, you didn't want to divide the audience per se.
Sure.
But, you know, when you go to an art institute, I'm not exactly sure how their curriculum is set up, but I would imagine there has to be some business sort of leaning there. As an entrepreneur coming from a professional setting, I'm sure you thought about all those things up front, even as you're creating your art.
Sure.
You know, or passionate about the thing that you're creating.
Yeah.
Where would you... You know, starting out doing this now, how would you guide someone who is in a similar situation as you? Maybe say they're a paralegal, but they have a passion for art and they want to go ahead and try to get started. What sort of process would you sort of guide them to from personal experience that would help them to kind of be where you're at right now?
Oh, sure. So I kind of had that type of journey. I was working full time and I decided to make the jump and try and make a profession out of it. So a lot of times I had no idea where to start really when I first decided to make that journey. So one of the things that I did was I just started to try to get involved in some of the things that were happening. I started going to galleries that were in my area, talking to the people that ran them, you know, and just trying to find out as much as I could about what was actually going on and how to do it. Cause I had no idea like what the process was to apply to a gallery, let alone be accepted by a gallery. You know, what level my work needed to be at, in order to display at a gallery,
right.
Because there's a certain expectation of, you know, that your work is presentable, that it's appealing, you know? So those were a lot of lessons that I had to learn myself. And so I would say that the best advice I could give to anyone who's thinking about making that journey is just to get involved, just get out there, hit the streets, as they say, you know,
right.
Go to galleries, talk to gallery owners, go to art shows, you know, talk to artists who are already at art shows, you know, pick their brain. That, I mean, we artists love to talk about art, you know, sure. I'm sure you love to talk about jewelry, you know, so, I mean, just get out there and meet the people that are doing it and try and learn from them. Surround yourself with great people that are doing the thing that is that you want to do, you know, and learn as much as you can from those people.
Yeah.
And they can kind of guide you as to where you would like to be. You know, if you say, I want to be an artist and I like painting, you know, and I would love to maybe have an exhibition one day or get my art in front of people and see what people think.
Right.
I mean, you can do that very easily. You know, you can apply to art shows, you can apply to galleries, you can show your art to your family, you know, to your friends and right. see who likes it, who appreciates it.
So in the art scene here in Kansas City, is there someone else out there that you draw inspiration from?
As far as Kansas City artists, you know, I'm
too small of a scope. Should you go further? I mean,
there are some great artists in Kansas City, but you know, with how accessible things are nowadays, you don't have to really limit yourself to just local people, although that's a great way to get inspired. You know, I follow artists, whatever basically strikes my fancy at the time is what I follow. I like to follow popular artists that do artwork that I like to, that I'm interested in. So I follow a lot of artists that I see that are, you know, doing great things and are very inspirational. And I try and kind of, not for a lack of a better term, copy what they do and just see how they find success. But there's a lot of artists out there that inspire me. You know, I like space art. I like modern art. So I always love to go to modern furniture stores and check out their modern furniture. And, right. Yeah. You know, and I love graffiti. Kansas City's got a great, a plethora of wonderful graffiti artists all over town. Artist Alley, down by the crossroads. It's just a complete alleyway full of graffiti art. That's incredible.
Right.
I would say that, I draw inspiration from a lot of different artists, probably too many to mention in one podcast, but
absolutely. And, you know, you talked about the fact that you also do some sculptures and things. Mm-hmm. Kansas City is great for our sculptures and fountains. And
absolutely.
Structures on a whole. And, you know, the way the city's set up from the grid. And I was talking to somebody that does city planning in another part of the country. And he was talking to me about Kansas City, the way the plaza area is set up. And he said it lends itself for it being very artistic in the way that it was fashioned. When you go to different cities or places that you've traveled, is that something that you look at, the way the city is set up, the sculptures that are in the squares or the downtown areas or things, or those things that you kind of pay attention to more so than maybe the average person?
Oh, I would say, I don't know if I pay attention to it more than the average person. I just like looking at awesome things.
Right.
So, you know, for me as myself, if I go to a city and I see that they've got, you know, giant sculptures commissioned, you know, or art installations for public use and public view out in the open, I feel it makes the space better. You know, it just makes people want to be there. You know, and it gives you a good feeling to be in that space because it's nice to look at. So I definitely see the value of a city having a wonderful art scene and having sculptures, and like Kansas City is known for its fountains. I was recently in Chicago. I saw the Bean for the first time.
Right.
And oh my God, I mean, there were tons of people from every nationality, you know, surrounding that thing, taking pictures. And it's just, it draws people in. And that's one of the reasons why I love art so much. And same thing with jewelry, you know, I mean, people look at jewelry as an expression of themselves and art, you know, and
I mean, you're very much an artist in those realms, and and those are things to be appreciated. And, you know, that creativity for someone who, like myself, who doesn't have that sort of creative mind to put it on canvas or sculpt it or things like you do, to be able to see someone do that, you know, there's nothing but appreciation for it.
Sure.
Even if they create something that doesn't particularly resonate with me like it would the next person. And I think that's, you know, what you mentioned earlier is, you know, if you're a fan of the creative mind that's behind it, you can be a fan of art.
Sure.
Even if you don't always find things that, you know, just say, hey, I love this. I'd hang it in my home, or I'd have it in my home.
Sure.
You know, and I think that's how people base things on. If you were to talk to someone who is not really familiar with art, and let's just say you're with them at a gallery, you just happen to run into somebody at a gallery, they've been dragged to this gallery. How would you tell them to look at art as a whole? What comes to your mind, you know, to tell them, well, I don't really know anything about art? Because I think people feel sometimes they don't like things because they don't understand.
Sure.
You know, that's kind of how we operate. You know, how would you tell them, well, this is how you get past that?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, human beings are very visual creatures. So I would just say, you know, look for things that, you know, you like, you know, is there something that speaks to you? you know, because your heart will tell you if it speaks to you.
Absolutely.
You know, you can maybe not know anything about art, but still find something that is beautiful to you or that speaks to you or that you feel like you could look at for, you know, hours on end. Mm-hmm. So it's, that's the good thing. The great thing about art is that it's very, like I said, subjective. Like, you know, you may not like something, but somebody else may like that, you know, or you may see something that's kind of what you like, and then you can look for things that are in that realm that are more of what you like, you know, that are more reflective of what you're looking for. So it's, I feel like it's like trying wine almost. You can, mm-hmm. you know, you try a few and some taste like, you know, a puddle water and some taste, you know, amazing. You know, you just have to, you just get in there and kind of, you know, feel out what you like. And then before you know it, you're, you know, drinking Pinot Grigio or whatever, you know. Cool. So you don't have to know anything really about art to appreciate it. It's, right. I feel like it's, you know, if you look at something and it speaks to you, then that's what art is, you know. Just a same with, you know, coming into your yeah. wonderful jewelry store, you know, I don't know Jack. I know Jack squat about diamonds, but right. I know when something looks gorgeous, you know, and I know if it speaks to me or, you know, and I mostly if it speaks to my wife.
Yeah, absolutely. We're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back with Casey Kempter of the Kansas City art scene. We're going to talk a little bit more to Casey about what's happening, what we can look for in Kansas City on the art scene, sure. a little bit more about the pandemic and then about his commission work. You don't want to miss our show, Dropping Jewels in Kansas City with Morgan. Good to be back after the holiday break. Talking to Casey Kempter.
I got a commercial on the can.
Okay. We'll do two.
Sure.
Casey first. Come on.
Okay. Oh, sure. Cool.
We have the pleasure of being in studio with Casey Kempter, who is a local artist here in Kansas City. And Casey, tell us a little bit about how individuals can get in touch with you to look at your work, where they can sure. find it and things of that nature.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm currently working on getting a website going. So I don't have that yet, but I mostly sell through Instagram, Facebook. I have a dedicated art page on Facebook. It's Casey Kempter Fine Art. And also you can find me on Instagram at Kempter, my last name, and that's KEMPTER.art. So right. those are the two avenues you can find me. And I do commissions all the time. I mostly work with contemporary modern art. I do a lot of abstract work, a lot of pencil, pen, sculpture, those types of things. But you can find my work there, and you can definitely contact me for any commissions as well.
And can they contact you via Facebook, Instagram, or do sure. you have a separate email address or phone number?
Sure.
Phone number you like to give them?
You guys can email me if you would like at Kempter, my last name, .art@gmail.com. So you can contact me there, but you can contact me through Instagram, Facebook. That's fine as well. Those are usually the avenues that people contact me through.
So check out Casey Kempter, a local artist here, amazing works, and he can give you a rundown on the Kansas City art scene. And we will post on our website the avenues in which you can get in touch with him.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Hey, Morgan.
Hey, John.
We're coming off the holiday season. Had a pretty good Christmas. Yeah. What can the people expect in the new year here in 2022?
Well, we'll just take it one month at a time, John.
All right.
This is January, and January is garnet month. And I have no less than 6 rare kinds of garnets already made up in my case over there.
All right.
Yep. And they're ready for your review, and I think you'll find them very inspirational and enlightening. I mean, some Savarite garnets to Umbelite garnets, Rhodolite garnets, Grossler garnets. I have them all set up. For the majority of them are set in rose gold, and we have several more that are in the process coming out, and I'm very excited to show them to people who come in.
And I'm very excited, too, because January is my birth month, and garnet is my birthstone. So come in to Jewelry by Morgan and check out the wonderful garnet pieces for January. We'll let you know what's happening in February and Valentine's Day accordingly. But right now, as Morgan mentioned, this is garnet month. So you need to come see Morgan and Scott at 6515 North Cosby Avenue, located in the Picture Hill Shopping Center. Come get an education. Talk to Morgan, the artisan that's been in business for over 40 years, one of the best. Actually, I scratched that. He is the best custom jeweler in town. And if there is something you see in the case that's not to your liking, he will be able to commission a piece for you. He can sit with you and get some drawings out and get you a piece that suits you. And he can have it set in garnet and whatever precious metal or stone you like.
Let me add to that also, and I now employ Christopher Becker, who's a savant, and he can draw anything you can think of right in front of you, right there on the spot. And once you agree to the terms of the commission, we will execute it and make it for you and get it done within 30 days.
Absolutely. Wow. So come see Morgan, Scott, and Chris to get your custom piece of jewelry. If you don't see something in the showcase, as I mentioned, but you got to come see us, 6515 North Cosby Avenue in the Picture Hill Shopping Center across from the DMV. And you can give Morgan a call at 816-587-6020. Jewelry by Morgan and Pond. And welcome back to the show. You're listening to Dropping Jewels in Kansas City with Morgan. I'm your co-host, John Donnelly, and we are have the pleasure of being joined in studio. If you missed us on the first half hour, go back and listen to the show. Chris Kempter, who is a local artist.
Casey Kempter.
I'm sorry.
Well, hey, you're Chris. Fine, John.
Casey Kempter, who is a local artist here in Kansas City. He has talked a lot about the Kansas City art scene. He's talked a lot about how he got started. And I wanted to talk to Casey about his commission work. And so talk to me a little bit about how you got on commissioning work. Obviously, being an entrepreneur, that is something that is probably important to you.
Sure.
To put some money in the coffers and also provide people pieces that they like.
Sure. Well, a lot of commission work comes from, you know, if somebody sees a piece of yours that they really like and perhaps it's sold already, or perhaps they just like the style of art that you do, you might often get approached to do commission work. Also, a lot of corporations, they commission artists for, you know, their offices or, you know, things of that nature. You know, if they have a, you know, an entryway that they often put, you know, they're going to want big, huge canvases to, you know, impress everybody as they walk in. So you would definitely probably get approached to do commission work if you're an artist who is practicing currently. So the way that I approach it is I just, you know, get a feel for what, you know, the client is wanting and what they're after, you know, what kind of result they're after. And then typically, you know, I take down a deposit to get started. And then I give them a time frame of when it'll be completed. So, and then I update them regularly throughout the process to, you know, show them how the work is coming, if it's to their satisfaction, and, you know, if, in case anything needs to be redone or if they want to go into a different direction. So that's typically how I handle commissions.
Absolutely. So these are one of a kind, unique pieces specifically for individuals. Have you ever gone back and asked them, hey, I'm pretty proud of this. Do you mind if I put this also in a gallery for a show?
Oh, sure. If sometimes, you know, if I'm doing a commission piece and I really love how it's going, you know, I may ask them if that's okay with them. And I may ask them, is it okay if I, you know, hang it in a gallery for a certain period of time? You know, I might give them a discount on their next piece to do so, you know, just so that they get something out of it. But right. Yeah, I do. I will do that from time to time. But typically, you know, once it's out the door, it's theirs to do whatever they would wish with. I might go a different route and display it for a while before I put it up for sale.
Okay.
So that's another way to do it as well. But yeah, that's definitely happened. And I will do that from time to time.
What's your best commission? Somebody we might know?
Well, I do a lot of like a residential commission. So I haven't necessarily done anybody famous yet, or I don't know if done's the right word, but I haven't done a commission for anybody notable yet. I would love to. So if you're out there, please get a hold of me. I would love to do a piece for you. For sure. I've done a lot of large scale work for residential and business and stuff like that, but I wouldn't say of anybody of note, you know.
Right. Is there any business that we could walk into and see your work?
Currently, right now, a lot of businesses, unfortunately, they don't have a lot of people in their office buildings. Kind of a weird thing to see right now. You know, all these corporations that have these huge buildings are now all of a sudden they don't need these buildings anymore. A lot of people have gone remote, which is kind of what I've seen on my end as well, you know.
Yeah. And you know, it's I'm glad that you mentioned that in the pandemic. I love when entrepreneurs come on the show and they talk about the effects. That's really how Morgan and I started this podcast was, you know, in the midst of or at the start of the pandemic, even, and Morgan being a business owner for 40 years saying let me know as I, you know, he helped me to grow my business. This is not the worst thing I've seen in my 40 years as a business owner.
Yeah.
And so you just getting started, like myself, probably around the same time, different businesses, different business models. In a different product, what have you had to do to pivot in order to sort of keep relevant, make your business grow?
Sure.
What avenues have you gone, you know, that you had to pivot from for when you started and said, okay, I can attend these galleries, these art shows will be coming up and, you know.
Yeah, it has definitely been a challenge to navigate. Certainly, I've never experienced anything like this in my lifetime.
Right,
a pandemic. You know, who would have thunk? Mm-hmm. Yeah, but absolutely. It is tough. I mean, it's tough right now. I think it's getting better. You know, like I said, I feel like we're turning a corner. But yeah, it is definitely. Tough waters to navigate. But as far as what have I had to do to change and to pivot, I would say, you know, definitely you need to have a strong online presence. You need to have a website to put out your work and get it seen, because they're just like right now, like there's just not that many places that even have, you know, people coming into their spaces, you know, sometimes, I mean, a lot of restaurants are still, you know, carry out only, you know, and they're just now getting into letting people come back in and dine in and stuff like that. And same with office buildings. A lot of office buildings are still remote only. Everybody's working from home. So, you know, you got to have an online presence. You have to have a website. You have to have a good social media presence, some of which I don't have all of yet, but I'm working on it.
We'll get you there.
Yeah, we'll get there. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, but I'm just starting out, trying to get my website going and everything like that. Perhaps when, you know, a couple months from now, if I come back, I can tell you guys how it went, how it's going, that kind of thing, you know, but, you definitely want to just make sure that people see your stuff. So it's more about driving traffic to your, you know, what it is that you're doing, bringing people in, delivering content, you know, because if you don't do a bunch, you know, or people don't see that you're, you know, have a new episode or a new painting up, you know, then they might lose interest. So you got to build that audience. So, that's what I would recommend as far as like pivoting in these times right now, just focus on, you know, drawing people in, getting people interested, talking to people.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, content is key to every business, you know, whether it's just what you have in stock, that's content, you know, all the things we do in the digital sphere, me and Morgan, that's content, what you're trying to do right now.
That's content.
And sometimes, you know, things like this, as bad as they seem in one aspect of business, can breed opportunity in another.
Absolutely.
And you know, I've looked at your Instagram. I've looked at your Facebook. It's very impressive.
Thank you.
You've got the website coming.
Yeah.
These are opportunities that, you know, as an entrepreneur, you have to look at. And one of the things Morgan and I noticed is that other businesses just could not move from the way they've done business for so long.
Yep.
And, you know, do you feel as though if you can get past this hurdle, knowing that you were coming into a pandemic, you know, you can set yourself up pretty good in the future in case something like this comes along. Cause I'm, you know, everything's cyclical. We'll see maybe not a global pandemic, but something that will affect the way we do business again, you know, and what advice would you give for those who are trying to start any business having, you know, these challenges presented to you in a medium that's, you know, in a business that's really visual, and historically people do have to come to a place to see what you have.
You know? Well, as far as art is concerned, to speak to what you just eloquently said is, you know, my advice to any entrepreneur that's trying to start a business in the pandemic, as it were, you know, is just keep at it, hard work, you know, move the ball a little bit every day, you know, because time's going to pass either way.
Right.
So if you knock out some maybe small goals daily or weekly, then you're still moving the ball. And as long as you're moving that ball, then you're going to get to your goal. But it all comes down to, in my opinion, hard work. And it is even harder right now with the pandemic, but thankfully people are still, you know, buying things. People still need jewelry. People still want art. I mean, jewelry is a billion dollar a year business. Art's a $1 billion a year business. I mean, people still consume and still buy things that they like to buy. So it's that's not going to change. Or people still need plumbing. People still need, you know, everything. So,
And then in you and Morgan's business, that is something that is, I don't want to just, you know, say it's a luxury, but it is something that as people are wanting to get back to normal are, you know, two things that people really want to come back and consume in the manner that they did.
Yeah.
And so I love what you said, because this is something Morgan has always told me in the 3 years I've known him. Keep moving the ball forward, set small goals.
Yeah.
If yesterday no one came in, tomorrow's a new day. Yeah. You don't know how many people will come in.
Exactly.
You know, we've had these conversations as recent as a week ago. You know, things, you know, you can't take what happens one day and assume that's going to be your next day.
Exactly.
You know, and that's
and
you know, that's really what makes an entrepreneur successful, is, you know, not taking, you know, taking it day by day, but not taking the day that's in front of you as the end all be all.
Sure.
And that's what's going to happen. And to me, you know, you had the conversation in the last half hour, you and Morgan both, about it never being a finished piece.
Sure.
You know, it's always something you're working on. And I feel like that in and of itself is business. You know, it's always something that you're working on, you know,
constantly.
And and so understanding that, has that helped you? I know you've probably had some moments where you're like, oh, my gosh, why am I doing this? You know, I got a family. I've got things. You know, I got bills. What has been the motivating factor for you to continue this? Has it been your passion for what you want to do, or is it a combination of things?
To me, it is my passion. I've like I said, I've been an artist my entire life. You know, since I was little, I was drawing and, you know, sculpting and stuff like that. So I always knew I wanted to be an artist. But I also knew I wanted to have healthcare and dental coverage. And so, you know, I chose to, you know, go the corporate route and have a traditional job. And, but once I got comfortable enough, you know, and I know not everybody out there has the same story. You know, once I got comfortable enough to where I could put more time into my passion, then I shifted gears and focused more on that. And it's what makes me happy, you know. And if you, there's that old adage that's, you know, is if you love what you do, you know, then it doesn't seem like you're like a job or, you know, a burden. You know, if you're in love with, you know, what you're doing to make a living, then it doesn't seem like work, you know, then you'll never work a day in your life or whatever.
Yeah, I get reminded of that all the time.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Absolutely.
Make it look like it's fun.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So, but there are hurdles, you know, everybody has doubts, you know, everybody hits those times where you're like, oh, is this going to work? Am I going to be able to make ends meet? You know? And I would, challenge everybody out there, you know, if you're in this position, to just think about, you know, that it can't rain all the time, you know, those hurdles are not always going to be there. And
can't snow all the time.
Yeah, it can't snow all the time, even though it's terrible outside right now. But yeah, exactly. There's always a better day around the corner.
You know, speaking of goals, I have to share this story. What I lived through was I knew this artist, Leo Durrell Chandler, down in Tulsa, Oklahoma. And he was married to Mary Ellen Smith, who had a talk show. And, of course, she did the news, and she knew everybody. And once a month, one of the writers, one of the reporters from the Tulsa Tribune, would go down to McAllister, Big Mac, the federal prison, right? Mm-hmm. And they would go down there, and they'd see what was going on. What's news from the Big Mac, they would say. Mm-hmm. And they found this cell of artists down there. Okay. And all these old dogs are down there, and they're trading techniques back and forth. And Leo, full-blood Cherokee Indian, he was doing this mural, and it was, I think it was probably 60, 70 by 70, something like that, big. And it was depicting this Indian on one side of this terrain, and there's a chasm between where the Indian was, and on the other side there was all this green pasture land and horses and fat little white kids and stuff like that. And then on the other side you got this emaciated horse, and the Indian doesn't look that good either. And he did, that was his project, doing that. And he didn't know what his goal was,
right?
But he did that painting, and they let him go.
What?
He got a full pardon from the governor.
Wow.
And then, you know, I did a show with him. He worked with us on this one radio show that we did. And one of the times that he had this table out in the living room, and around it were all these artists that worked with him in the federal prison. Mm-hmm. And they had all been released from prison because they were artists. And they had their own little place where they exhibited stuff, and they sold, they got commissioned and all this stuff.
Wow.
So I looked at that, and I said, oh, there's a goal for you.
Yeah.
Let me go.
You heard it here first, folks. If you're in prison, do some art, you might get out.
Well, I guess there's all kinds of prisons out there.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
We make them for ourselves.
Oh, right, absolutely.
And is, you know, coming from the corporate world myself, doing actually essentially the same thing, you know, entrepreneur, you know, being an entrepreneur sometimes comes out of necessity. I got laid off from a big, you know, as an account manager, Morgan being one of my accounts.
Yeah.
And he just looked at me, and I told him, the conversation was, I'm no longer going to be your account manager.
Yeah.
I was like, why don't you do your own thing? Yeah. And, you know, that's how we formed our relationship.
That's right.
That's how I formed my business. So yeah. We all have stories as an entrepreneur. And,
right.
And, you know, him, his the catalyst for him was his dad mm-hmm. doing the same thing and yep. looking like he was happy every day. And Morgan was like, I want to be that guy.
Yeah. That's right.
And you know, one of the things that occurred to me as being an artist is there's a process involved. And you said that you've got to be passionate about what you do.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not just the finished product. It's you got to be passionate about the process.
Sure.
And when you are doing pieces, and I'm going to get you out of here on this because we're pressed for time.
Okay.
Is it, do you find yourself as you're doing the process, even if you're, oh no, this doesn't look good. Start. Do you ever feel at any time frustrated or like, why am I doing this? Or are you still in love with the process, so to speak?
Well, I mean, as an artist, I love creating things, you know? So, I mean, there's times that I get frustrated when I'm creating a piece that if it's not going the way I want it to go, or if I'm, I had something that looked great and then I screwed it up, you know, because that can happen too, you know, from, it's, you know, we're all our own worst critics, you know, so sometimes, you know, I'll work on something and I'll think it's looking great and then I'll do something to it and I'll be like, ah, crap, I totally, you know, totally jumped the gun on that one and screwed it all up. Now it looks like crap. So, you know, you just got to keep at it. And sometimes I'll do a whole painting over again, you know, and just scrap it and start over, you know, it happens to the best of us. So, you know, it can suck, you know, when you're doing something and you really think you got something and then you overwork it, mess it up, but you just got to keep at it and try again.
Absolutely. Yeah. Morgan, you got anything for Casey before we let him go and go off the air?
Well, you're a very interesting character. I'm looking forward to hearing future stories from
you. Oh, absolutely.
And, I'm looking forward to when you go out there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I'm currently working on getting my own studio space as well as a gallery going. So hopefully the target is June or July of this year.
Cool.
So hopefully if I come back or lucky enough to come back and talk to you guys again, I'll have some updates for you and I'll have some artists I can recommend for you as well.
Absolutely. We'll be hounding you to come back.
Okay.
Don't worry about that.
All right.
We're going to do that YouTube thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
So that'll be a medium that'll work right well with.
Okay,
absolutely.
Cool.
Yeah, with Jewelry by Morgan Television, we'll get you some exposure.
Oh, nice. All right.
And
exciting
right,
things.
Right now, where can people mention again how people can get in touch with you, where they can find your work, where they can get in touch with you to commission work?
Sure. You can find me again on Instagram. It's Kempter, my last name, KEMPTER.art, A-R-T. You can also find me on Facebook, Casey Kempter Fine Art. So you can follow me or like and see what I have working, what I'm working on right now through those channels. You can also email me at kempter.art@gmail.com. You can get a hold of me that way. And I'd love to talk to anybody that's got any questions or if you have any desire to get a commission done by me, I'd be happy to talk to you. Or if you'd even just like to get some art in your space, I'd love to be able to hang some stuff and get you some visual appeal going.
Absolutely.
Great.
And if you were unable to write down all that information, we will have all the URLs and email addresses in the body of this episode lead in. So look for the episode. Just go to www.jewelrybymorgan.com. Click on the listen to our podcast button and you will find this interview with Casey Kempter on there, and it'll have all his information on how you can get in touch with him. Feel free to reach out to him, ask him any questions about the Kansas City art scene, look through his collection, his work, and commission something, you know, because he does great work. And it's been a pleasure to have you in studio today.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for coming to Absolutely. Us on a little bit of short notice.
Oh, sure. No problem.
It. And we will have you back soon. But we're going to go ahead and sign off. It's been great to be back. And we have shows in the following week. Just continue to listen to Dropping Jewels in Kansas City with Morgan. I'm your co-host, John Donnelly. Morgan Fleming is your host.
Thank you.
He's been in studio today. And God bless everyone in the new year. Continue to love one another. Take care of each other. And let's get through what's happening in the world, pandemic and everything else. And get back to doing things like going to art galleries and appreciating fine art.
Absolutely.
All right. Everyone have a wonderful Monday and a wonderful rest of the week.
Go Chiefs.
Go Chiefs.
Yay.